Welcome to the North Carolina A&T Men's Basketball Coaches Show with head coach Will Jones. Here's your host, Spencer Turner.
Welcome in for another edition of the North Carolina A&T Basketball Coaches Show. I'm the voice of the Aggies, Spencer Turkin, joined by the head man, Will Jones. As we start to recap what's happened over the past week, we look forward to a huge week for North Carolina A&T men's basketball as we start to come down the stretch of the Big South season. So let's go ahead and welcome in the head man, Will Jones. Coach, as always, a pleasure to speak with you here on the Coach's Show. I know we're coming off a week that you probably wish you could have back.
Yeah, great to be back. Another week. Last week, man, though, so close. You know, you start off with Campbell, and you're right there with Longwood. And then this weekend against Upstate, some steam kind of out of our sails against Upstate. But you want to win them all, man. You want to win them all. The guys laid it on the line both nights, you know, those first two. And we just came out on the short end. And I think that took a lot out of us because they were ready to play. And we had a letdown on Saturday. But in this business, you gotta get up off the ground, and you gotta be ready. And we gotta get ready for Thursday this week versus Winthrop.
Coach, let's go to that Longwood game since you mentioned it. Your guys led for almost the entire way up in Farmville. And then at the very end, just could not keep that lead. What did you like in that game out of your squad? And what were some things that you were hoping that they would correct?
Yeah, I mean, I like our preparation. I like our execution for the majority of the game. At the end of the game is when, you can't have costly turnovers. You can't miss free throws. You got to make them earn everything. And I think without, turning the ball over, they weren't able to get in transition. We were able to defend. And we kept them at bay for the entire game right until the end. And those they made a couple of threes, and those threes came out of turnovers, so they converted turnovers into points and really got them excited. Their backs were against the wall. We were in control. Man, I wish I could have that one back. But hopefully we can learn from it.
51 second half points is what your squad gave up. It seems like, though, the three-point line has been just killer for your team when it comes to the opponent. Your opponents are shooting right around 34%. On the season from downtown, and you look at it also, and then in conference, opponents, while they're only shooting 32.8%, you look at it in games really here over the last stretch, and it feels like opponents are shooting almost 40% from downtown. What can you try and get your guys to do to close in on the three-point arc?
Yeah, it's crazy. They're shooting like that at home. The two home games that we've had, the Campbell game and the Upstate game, the teams are just shooting lights out. We have to do a better job of being there on the catch and contesting. Campbell and Upstate are two of the better shooting teams in the conference. And we did have them in that stretch last week. I thought against Longwood, we took the three away, something that they do well. We took the three away and was able to neutralize that and really made it tough for them to score. They scored a ton of points on the free throw line, in the second half exclusively. But we got to get back to, just being there on the catch, playing with more intensity defensively, and not giving guys, wide open shots. And to be honest with you, some of those shots have been highly contested. They just have been going in. And sometimes that's how the ball bounces.
What does it take to get that out of the guys, to get that next level of defensive intensity? Does it have to come from within? Does it come from the staff? Is there a certain person on the roster that has to try and get it out of them? I mean, what does it take?
You know, I truly believe, you know, we're getting teams' best games. I mean, we're getting teams' best games. I think that, you know, the Club Corbett, you know, we got to go in there. It's going to be crazy. You guys got to be ready to play. I think these teams are really taking that thing seriously. And they're coming in there focused and ready to play. You know, it's one of the better atmospheres that they get a chance to play in. And so they're coming in ready, guns blazing. And we got to just be ready. We haven't played well in our building. And a lot of times crowd going against the atmosphere to a feat to where it's pressure on that other team because of the noise, because of what's going on. We just haven't been able to sustain the level of excitement that we've been accustomed to. And, you know, I've been trying to figure that out for a little bit. Maybe, you know, we got a lot of new guys that haven't played in Corbett, and they still are getting adjusted to playing there. And so that's something that, you know, continue to talk about because that environment, you have to be mature. You have to be mature to play in that environment. And I think sometimes in some of the new guys, they get a little bit trigger happy and, you know, playing a little bit for the crowd instead of playing for the team.
It's been something that I think has been noted on some of the broadcasts. At certain points in games, there's the tendency of multiple guys, it's not just one person, to start to try and put the team on their back and try and play outside of themselves. Is that something that maybe you need to recognize early and pull them and let them know, hey, if you're going to play like that, that's not going to work? Or is it a maturity thing and they need to work through that?
You know, it's like it's every couple of games, man. It's not an every game thing. And, you know, I was talking to the staff today. We have played much better on the road than we have played at home. And, again, that's something to figure out and look at, you know, who needs to be in. Obviously, we need everybody to play, whether we're home or on the road. But, again, it's a maturity thing. I think it's a maturity thing. And Why are we playing? We're playing to win. We're playing to win as a unit. The crowd is here to support us. The fans are here to support us. Your family's here to support us. But we can't forget the main thing when we're out on the court. And that main thing is to play together, to go out there and have fun, and to win. And I think that, you know, this group, as of yet, you know, hopefully we can get there, is still playing with the idea that it's me. I have to be the one. And that's not really how I want to coach or my teams have played in the past. I'm more of a team that coach that wants to share the wealth. I don't want one guy to get 30 and the rest of the guys to get 7. I want more balance in our scoring. And that takes trust between them and belief. And that's something we talked about today and we'll continue to talk about.
One of the major factors that led to the rise of this most recent version of Club Corbett was the amount of dunking that your teams would do. The Dunkyard Dogs, they were getting after it above the rim and finding the basketball and putting it home. Is that something that is missing from this team, that oomph to put the ball through the rim?
Yeah, I mean, I wish that chemistry would be something that automatically comes. Obviously, your roster turns over. You have new guys, and new guys bring different attributes. Even if you think in recruiting that they're athletic enough or they can do that, what I would say is that our younger guys, our freshmen, we have that's still on the horizon. But those guys are young right now. We have a couple guys that can play like that are long and rangy, but they're just not ready right now to be out there. This team is talented piece by piece. And when you're talented piece by piece, those pieces have to recognize, hey, man, that other piece is pretty good, too. That piece can help me. And I think some games we realize that, and I think some games it's, man, I'm going to put me first. And it's not a selfish thing. It's just an immature thing that some of these guys have to learn. And you want to be playing your best basketball going into the tournament. And so hopefully we can coach them. I can correct it. We can talk about it and get these guys back playing solid basketball at the right time going into the Big South tournament.
Coach, you for a couple of years while you were on the staff, there was a young man who is a fan favorite in Denzel Keys that was a football player that that came over and played some basketball as a walk-on on the basketball team. And he brought a different element than what you usually see on a basketball team. He brought that toughness that you find not only physically but mentally. If you had a wish list and there was a football player on the roster right now that you could have show up and drop him into the locker room to just walk on to the squad for the rest of the year, would you have one? Would you want somebody to try and bring a different element of mental toughness to this team?
You know, that piece is really important. You know, Denzel Keys, he came to the game this weekend. And I was telling Jeremy Robinson today a little bit about Denzel and what he brought. And to be honest with you, when we recruited Ron Jackson was recruited to take Denzel Keys, his role, right? And he did a heck of a job at it. You know, heck of a job at it. He wasn't a football player, but he was relentless, athletic. He was a great teammate, great defender, and he turned out to be that intangible guy. And that wasn't a year one thing also. That happened more in year two. And so a lot of times it is the process. You know, you would love to have that intangible guy. Anytime you can get that intangible guy that has that makeup, that toughness, that resolve to always be ready and up for the challenge. You want that on your roster. You know, when I was at South Carolina State as a player, we had a guy just like that. And it doesn't really matter what position, but that mindset helps you in the locker room.
Coach, we got plenty more coming up here on the Men's Basketball Coaches Show. We'll take a week. A look at the week ahead, and it is a big one for North Carolina A&T, a national television appearance, and another tough game in the Charlotte area. We'll be back with more right here on the Basketball Coaches Show on the Aggie Sports Network. Welcome back to the North Carolina A&T Basketball Coaches Show. I'm the host, Spencer Turkin, the voice of the Aggies, alongside the head coach, Will Jones, as we start to look ahead at the coming up week. Really, Coach, it really might not get bigger than this in Big South basketball. You head to Rock Hill to take on Winthrop on national television on ESPNU Thursday at 7 p.m., and then you bump over to Gardner-Webb, and the Running Bulldogs have been playing some really good basketball too. Of course, a former assistant coach at A&T, Andrew Brown, is on staff over at Gardner-Webb. So let's go ahead and start with Winthrop. Anytime you head to Rock Hill, you are in for a dogfight. They are a solid team top to bottom.
Yeah, I mean, Winthrop has traditionally been good. You know, they have been solid the whole season. They have lost the last two out of three games on their side. Lost to Longwood this weekend right after we played. You know, every team in this league can win on any night, and that's what makes it unique. This well-balanced. And the thing that I feel strongly, and I've told the staff this today, right now I feel more confident going on the road with this group than playing at home, because at least we have consistently got the level of focus that you need to be in a big game. And so I feel confident with the Aggies going down to Rock Hill. We are a different group to play against. Outside of everybody in the league, we're big, we're versatile, and we're talented. All of those things have to come together to make us the best version of ourselves. And that's still a process that's still ongoing. And we're up for the challenge. We talked about it today. We'll continue to talk about it for the rest of the week. We leave on Wednesday. But this group is not afraid to play anywhere that we have to play. We just know we have to put it together for 40 minutes and not leave anything on the table.
There's going to be quite the big man matchup in this ball game. I think a lot of people are looking forward to it, to see what Colin Smith can do over in Rock Hill, really along with Justin Watley and Webster Fillmore and the rest of the big guys. But Colin, starting to get a lot more comfortable in an Aggie uniform and becoming a bigger piece of the offense, do you feel like he has settled into the league and has understood how to play in the Big South when it comes to the way he's officiated and the way the ball moves through him?
Yeah, I think it's a game-by-game thing. I think he's continuing to get in shape. For us, continuing to learn how to play with a big that can score, the dynamics of your team a little bit changes, because you're trying to make sure you get those inside touches and guards, looking inside and not playing so much perimeter-oriented basketball. But again, in any process, that the more you do it, the better you get at it. And, certainly teams are coming in preparing for it and, trying to make sure that one thing Colin does is draw fouls. Colin plays physical. He's played in a league, a couple of notches above our league. And sometimes his physicality is penalized in this league because he's used to playing against bigger, stronger players. And this league is more smaller, quicker. He's getting used to that piece, smaller, quicker post players. Just trying to figure out, again, like you said, settling in and understanding how this league is officiating the game, especially on his end. Sometimes he gets frustrated because – they do call some things, some knick-knack things on him that probably wouldn't get called for in the American League.
Coach, when you think about what is in store for the Aggies on Thursday night, an opportunity to show the country, really, that they are going to be a factor in Charlotte for the Big South tournament, is that a message that even has to be conveyed to your squad, or do they understand that already?
Yeah, I think our guys know how good we are. I think they know how good we are. I think they look at, this last week, we could easily be at the top of our league right now. You're talking about 1.5 seconds at Campbell, a mental mistake, and you're talking about the last 3 minutes at Longwood where self-inflicted wounds impacted our ability to leave Farmville with a W. And so I think they know we're good and we can play against whoever we play, wherever we're playing, on the road or at home. And so, yes, they know this week is a big-time game. We're going to go on the road and play Winthrop. But again, man-to-man, we're always going to have an advantage. It's up to us to figure out that chemistry that allow that advantage to prevail for 40 minutes.
You mentioned the man-to-man advantage, but also the 1-3-1 advantage is something I don't think gets enough publicity. When you stick Justin Watley, 6'9", 6'10", at the top of the 1-3-1, how hard is that for a team to have to play against?
Yeah, it's been good when he's out there. Justin, he's gotten foul trouble, a couple of games early. And when he gets in foul trouble, it really hurts us because – he is, you know, for this version of this team, he is the best guy at the top of the 1-3-1 that makes it difficult. He plays it with IQ, and but he's been, you know, the foul trouble, he's been getting one or two fouls early, you know, during that first half, and we have to sit him. And we're not as good at the 1-3-1 this year if he's not at the top. It's something that, you know, up until last week, I have to look at the numbers. I mean, we were the best zone team in the country per possession, you know, teams that played over 100 possessions. We were giving up the less amount of points. But when you play zone, you got to play with 110% effort. All five guys have to be on the same page. You got to live and die. You just got to play as hard as you can. And you can't have any letdowns at any spot. And, it's hurt us a little bit in a couple of games because we haven't been dialed in and chasing. And again, at home. At home, it's been as good traditionally. At home has been really when we really lay it down on people. But again, you have to learn each team and what each team is a little bit better at and kind of continue to try to improve.
Well, Coach, it's time for your favorite part of the show, What's Up in Will's World. So we're going to step off the basketball court and see what's going on in your world, even though I'm pretty sure it's just a whole bunch of film watching and trying to get ready for the week.
Yeah, big week. my wife's birthday is this weekend. And so other than watching film and figuring that out, I got to figure out how to make sure home is happy too. And so I'm trying to figure out what that birthday present looks like and how to make sure the home continues to have – I can win games at home. I need to be able to win games at home.
There you go.
So, that's the thing that I'm going to be my mind will be chasing around, trying to make sure I make the right choice and make sure my wife is happy for a birthday.
Coach, I got to tell you, I built my smoker this weekend. And so at some point, I'm thinking that you and I are going to have to wheel the smokers out and we're going to have a little smoke off before after practice one day and see if we have a little cook off what the guys like a little better. I'm just saying, hey, listen, I can throw down.
Hey, listen, it's always good to have some smoke in the air. I like people that take time and even want to smoke meat because smoke meat, it takes an art. And I've got my guys on the staff. They're interested. They're doing it now. And so now I need to see what you got going on over there.
Man, I got an offset smoker, two chambers. I mean, the thing is a dog now. I mean, it's ready to go. So, you know, we might have to wheel some stuff out after practice and we'll have a little taste test. We'll see what the guys think. But
I need to do that for sure.
But, you know, Coach, I guess, are there similarities between, you know, the patience needed for smoking meat and the patience needed to develop a basketball team and make sure that they're peaking at the right time right before the tournament?
It is a process. It is a process. You can't get too high. You can't get too low. You got to look at your team every day and see where they are, understand the individuals on the team, and really kind of put them and try to put them in the right positions every day, not just every game, every day. And like I said, one of the things I spent some time on this weekend, specifically on Sunday, is stepping back, realizing that these young men laid it on the line this weekend and came up just short in that we're a good team. There are things we have to shore up that we will continue to get practice at and try to shore up to give them the unbelievable amount of confidence to go out and play. And so, you know, in this league, you play those two games every week, one home, one away. Most of the time, this first wave of this four games is two on the road first with Winthrop and Gardner-Webb. But in the blink of an eye, with some resolve and toughness and will and togetherness, you can look up and be on a two-game win streak. And we just got to do it one day at a time, one practice at a time, and go in this week with the 1-0 mindset to go in there and try to beat Winthrop and get that job done.
Coach, we always appreciate the time. Best of luck to you and the Aggies this week. It's a big one on the road. Winthrop, Thursday, 7 p.m. in Rock Hill, and then on to Gardner Webb at 2 o'clock on Saturday. That'll do it for us here on the A&T Basketball Coaches Show. For the head man, Will Jones, I'm Spencer Turkin saying so long till Thursday night. We'll talk to you from Rock Hill right here on the Aggie Sports Network.